Tonight we're in Mark chapter 9, and we're going to conclude this chapter by looking at verses 42 through 50. And we're in the bigger section, which is a journey to Jerusalem. And beginning in chapter 10, next week, we'll look at Jesus moving in the direction of Jerusalem. There are several things that take place during this journey. The first is the healing of a blind man at Bethsaida, which in many ways is a parable and also a miracle, because Jesus had to heal him really twice. It was a two-stage healing, and the disciples, in their efforts to figure out who Jesus is and what Jesus is going to do, that's going to be a process. And so in many ways, that healing symbolizes the process of learning that the disciples are going through. Then we had the first passion prediction and the teaching. Jesus, for the first time, tells his disciples, I'm going to be rejected, I'm going to suffer, I'm going to die, and I'm going to rise from the dead. And that was brand new information for them. That was information they did not want to hear. In fact, Peter's initial response to what Jesus said was to tell Jesus, that's never going to happen to you. That should never happen to you. But Peter didn't understand that that was God's plan for Jesus' life. Jesus' rejection, suffering, death, and resurrection are not accidents. They're part of God's plan. And Jesus knew what God's plan was. Now he's trying to convince the disciples that that's God's plan. But the disciples are going to be a little slow in understanding that. Then we looked at the healing of a boy with an evil spirit. And again, the emphasis was not so much upon the miracle, but the disciples. The disciples failed to do this miracle. When Jesus was on Mount Transfiguration, they had a chance to cast out that evil spirit, and they couldn't do it. Jesus does it, and then they ask the question, why couldn't we do that? And Jesus says, this was a hard case. This was a difficult thing. And these kinds only come out by prayer. So it may take a process for these miracles, for these healings to take place. We're in this section called the Second Passion Prediction and Teaching. For the second time, Jesus will tell the disciples that he's going to die and rise from the dead. This time, he interjects a word meaning to hand over. That word can be translated betrayed. So for the first time, Jesus introduces the idea that he's going to suffer and die because of a betrayal that's going to take place. And of course, we know that's exactly what happens. Following this particular announcement, the disciples get into a discussion, a friendly argument, about who of the 12 is the greatest. I guess they wanted to rank each other. You know, this is disciple number one and all the way down to number 12. But they were arguing about who was the greatest. And Jesus overhears them. Jesus then questions them about it, and they get really quiet because they don't want to admit that that's what they were talking about. Then Jesus begins to introduce something interesting. There's a difference between human values and the values of God's kingdom. There's a difference between cultural values and the values of God's kingdom. Jesus says to the disciples, cultural values will ask the question, who is the greatest? But as a citizen of God's kingdom, you should never ask that question. Instead, you should ask the question, who can I serve today? Whose life can I make better today? That's the question you ought to be asking. Because if you want to be great in God's kingdom, don't try to be first. Just admit that you're last. And then go serve somebody and help them. So there's this clash that's going to take place between kingdom values and cultural values. The second story is that there was this man who's not named, and he was casting out demons in Jesus' name. And John and the other disciples tell him to stop doing that because this man did not belong to the 12. In other words, he wasn't one of the 12 disciples, so he should stop doing that. But Jesus said, no, he should not stop doing that, Do not keep that individual from doing that in my name. Because obviously, if he's casting out demons in my name, he believes in me. He's not going to say anything negative about me. He's not against us, so he's for us. And then Jesus goes on to tell the disciples that when you're ministering in my name, people may do nice things for you just because of me. And those people who do nice things to you because of me will get a great reward. And that's where we stopped last week. Tonight we're going to look at warning against offenses. We get into a section of material where Jesus says some things that make people uncomfortable. If Jesus were up here talking and saying the things that he said, you'd probably squirm a little bit in your seat. You would go, did he really say that? Did he really mean that? Or what does he mean by that? That's what's going to take place in this section. Now, there is a question about where this section actually begins. And we're going to begin it in verse 42. Some commentators begin the section with verse 41, some with verse 43. And I'll explain that in a little more detail as we get into verse 42. But in verse 41, there's the idea of giving a disciple a cup of water in Jesus' name. So in other words, if you help a disciple, you're going to receive a reward. That's a very positive statement, verse 41. Verse 42 is going to say, if you hinder a disciple, if you cause a disciple to stumble in their faith, you will be judged. So there's a contrast. Help a disciple, get rewarded. Hinder a disciple, receive judgment. So there's the contrast between those two ideas. Now, all of these sayings are grouped together because of some catchwords. We go from one saying to the next because there's a phrase or a word that links them together. And some of the catchphrases in this section are offense, stumbling, fire, and salt. So we're going to look at verses 42 through 50 tonight, and it's a warning about offenses. So let me read those verses, and then we'll talk about them one by one. Mark chapter 9, beginning with verse 42. If anyone causes one of these little ones, those who believe in me, to stumble, it would be better for him if a large millstone were hung around their neck and they were thrown into the sea. If your hand causes you to stumble, cut it off. It's better for you to enter life maimed than with two hands to go into hell, where the fire never goes out. And if your foot causes you to stumble, cut it off. It is better for you to enter life crippled than to have 2 feet and be thrown into hell. And if your eye causes you to stumble, pluck it out. It's better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have 2 eyes and be thrown into hell, where the worms that eat them do not die and the fire is not quenched. Everyone will be salted with fire. Salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can you make it salty again? Have salt among yourselves and be at peace with each other. So some rather interesting sayings that Jesus delivers to the disciples, and it all begins in verse 42. If anyone causes one of these little ones. Now, Jesus had used that phrase a few verses ago to talk about a child. And when the disciples were arguing about who was the greatest, Jesus brings in a child, apparently either Simon Peter's child or Andrew's child, and says, see this child? I want you to be like this child if you want to be great, which was quite a stir for the disciples because children in the first century were at the very bottom of the family totem pole. They weren't at the top. But this time, Jesus uses the phrase, the little ones, to refer to someone who believes in him. So this is a Christian perhaps a new Christian. Maybe that's why Jesus called this individual a little one. It's a brand new believer. Or maybe it's a believer that's kind of weak in their faith. They don't understand much. They haven't grown much. They're kind of fragile. So you have to be careful how you deal with them. They're a little one. Then Jesus talks about those from the outside who cause one of his followers to stumble. And the word stumble means to trip. It's the idea to trip up in your faith, or perhaps even to lose your faith. So Jesus is saying, if someone causes one of these believers in me, a new believer, to stumble and lose their faith or trip all over their faith, then judgment is coming. It's a reminder that we need to be careful how we handle new Christians. New Christians don't know much. Remember when you became a Christian and you didn't know much? I was back in the fifth grade. I didn't know much. I just knew I was a sinner. I wasn't perfect, and I needed Jesus as my Savior. That's pretty much all I knew. I didn't know any of the big theological words. I didn't know who wrote what book in the Bible, or if a book was in the Old Testament or the New Testament. I didn't know that. I was brand new. I was handed this book that has 66 books in it, and I knew very little about any of it. That's where we start. Sometimes new Christians say things wrong. They may mess up their theology. Or sometimes even new Christians say words that Christians aren't supposed to say because they're used to saying those words. We need to be careful how we deal with new Christians. Our goal is to nurture them and grow them in their faith. Our goal is not to, be this person, I've been a Christian for 40 years now, and I know all of this, and, this is what I'm telling you to do, and you can turn people off. We need to be careful how we deal with new Christians. I'm sure there are many people who made a profession in Jesus, got around some Christians who thought they knew everything, and this person obviously knows very little, and they were treated harshly by these other Christians. So much to the point where they're going, wow, this is what it means to go to church and hang around Christians. Maybe I don't want to be one. That's what Jesus is talking about. Be careful not to cause one of the little ones to stumble. Nurture them, grow them. And a great way to grow them is to get them in a group Bible study, whether it's a D-Life group or whether a Sunday school group on Sunday, so they can begin growing. Also involve them in a ministry where you can train them and help them grow. But we need to be careful not to cause them to stumble. And when they make mistakes and say things wrong, we need to be gentle and kind as we try to correct them. Now, there are some commentators who think this verse belongs with the last story. And maybe it does. The last story is when John and the other disciples told the man who was casting out demons in Jesus' name, stop doing that. Why should you stop doing that? Because you don't belong to our group. I mean, the disciples thought, hey, we're the 12. Other people shouldn't be casting out demons. That Jesus gave us the commission to do that. Jesus didn't tell anyone else to do that, just us. And the irony of that whole argument was the disciples had just failed to cast out a demon, and apparently this man was successful in casting out the demon. But that man may have thought, wow, one of Jesus' top disciples just told me not to do that anymore. Well, maybe I shouldn't do that anymore. Wow, and maybe I don't really want to follow Jesus anymore either. So Jesus is saying, be careful. Don't cause one of those little ones to stumble. And it's a great warning for us today. Be careful, be kind, be gentle, especially with new believers. Then Jesus goes on to say, if you do cause them to stumble, it would be better for you if a large millstone were placed around your neck. And back in the first century, they would grind the grain in two different ways. There was the large millstone that was turned by a donkey, an animal. Then there was the hand millstone that was used by women. This is the big one. This is a big stone that would go around your neck. And if they tied it to your neck and tossed you into the water, you're going to sink to the bottom and you're going to die. So Jesus is making us uncomfortable now. Because Jesus is saying, if you offend one of these little ones who believe in me, it would be better for you just to die than to face what you really deserve for doing that. So Jesus tells us to be very careful about how we treat people. Not to offend them. Don't cause them to have a spiritual shipwreck. A person's faith is a very delicate thing. You need to nurture people. Don't turn them off. And as I look at our culture today, unfortunately, there's a lot of people who at one point in their life claimed allegiance to Jesus, who now claim no allegiance to Jesus because somebody turned them off. And that somebody was probably not Jesus. That somebody was somebody else claiming to follow Jesus. So we need to be careful in how we deal with new believers. Verse 43 switches the idea, but this whole idea of stumble repeats. So the catch word is stumble. Verse 42 talks about somebody from the outside causing you to stumble and perhaps lose your faith. Verse 43 is about you causing yourself to stumble and perhaps even lose your faith. So Jesus talks about if your hand causes you to stumble, you should cut it off. And again, Jesus is making us very uncomfortable. He's going to then talk about the foot causing you to stumble, and he says cut that one off too. Then if your eye causes you to stumble, you're to pluck that one out. Now, Jesus is actually talking in metaphor. This is hyperbole. It's interesting that some people throughout the history of the church have taken this literally, and they've done some really weird and wacky things because of that. But Jesus is saying this in terms of hyperbole, but at the same time, Jesus wants us to take this seriously. If there's something in your life that's keeping you from following God, if there's something in your life that's keeping you from becoming a Christian, get rid of it. Discard it. Because it's not worth it. And as we look at this passage, as it develops later on, there's going to be some examples of some people who said no to Jesus for certain reasons. One was possessions and riches. It was a young man who was living for all of his wealth and all of his possessions. And Jesus tells him, go sell everything you have, give it to the poor, and come follow me, and you'll have riches in heaven. And the man says, no. My life's about my possessions and my money. I'm not giving it up. And he walks away. There's another passage about family pressure keeping people from faith in Jesus. I would follow you, Jesus, but my family wouldn't like that. In fact, they'd probably disown me. They'd probably write me out of the will. So I'm not going to do that. And back in the first century, especially under the Roman government, as we move through history, following Jesus may cost me my earthly life. And I'm not willing to give that up. So no thanks. And they walk away. Things that keep people from following Jesus. Money, possessions, family, fear for their own life, maybe power, position, prestige, things people are not willing to give up in order to follow Jesus. But Jesus says those things have to go. It's kind of like a surgeon. And for example, if your hand is diseased, if it's filled with bacteria, you have a choice. Lose your hand and live, keep your hand and die. That's kind of the picture that Jesus gives. So whatever is keeping us from Jesus has to go. And the Apostle Paul understood this, and it's interesting what he writes. First of all, in Romans chapter 8, verse 13, he uses a slightly different metaphor. Paul says, if you live according to the flesh, you're going to die. But if you by the Spirit, you put to death the misdeeds of the body. So put to death the misdeeds of the body that are keeping you from God. And God's Spirit will help you do that. Jesus says, cut off those things. Paul says, put them to death. And again, they're both using metaphors. He also says, Paul does, in Colossians chapter 3, verse 5, put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature. And he's going to define this in terms of sins. Jesus talks about body parts that lead to sin. Paul is now going to specifically list the sins that can keep people from God. Sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. An example, sexual immorality. Some people decide, you know what? I don't want to marry this person, but I do want to live with them, and I know it's wrong, but I'm going to do it anyways. And they do it. Or another person may say, you know, I know adultery is wrong, but I really like this other person better than the one I'm married to right now. So I'm just going to divorce this person and marry this other person, and it's just going to be okay. And then they start feeling guilty. So how do they deal with their guilt? Well, just stop going to church. You know, going to church makes them feel guilty, but golfing on Sunday morning or boating on Sunday morning doesn't. So what do? They choose the sin and just push God right out of their life. And Jesus and Paul says, don't do that, because it's not worth it to do that.
Tim, all of us know and have plastered all over the media the situation with Dr. Charles Stanley and his wife. Now, that came up in many discussions. Charles Stanley did a magnificent job, and before everybody, to allow his family to be torn apart. And he did not do anything but just allow to take place what really took place between him and his wife as a minister.
Right, true. Yep. So Jesus, when he talks about in this passage, is going to talk about three body parts that are linked to sin. He's going to talk about the hand in verse 43. The hand might steal things, take things that don't belong to it. Then there's the foot in verse 45. And the foot may go to places you're not supposed to go or hang around people you're not supposed to hang around with and be influenced by them. And then there's the eye, and the eye is normally linked to lust, whether it's a sexual lust or a material lust. You know, I have to have that. My neighbor has a new car. I need a new car. And my new car needs to look just as good, if not better, than my neighbor's new car, and it becomes greed. And so Jesus is talking about all three of those. And I'm going to skip verse 44 for a moment. I'll come back to it. Verse 45 talks about the foot. And it's interesting, in all three of these situations, Jesus begins with a conditional clause, if. So if your foot causes you to stumble, if your foot causes you to do things that will keep you away from God. So that's the clause. And then it's followed by the recommendation. And Jesus' recommendation is to cut it off. Get rid of it. Why? Then there's the comparison. It's better for you to enter life crippled than to have 2 feet and be thrown into hell. So Jesus is talking about eternal life and eternal punishment, because that's what's at stake in your relationship with God. If you have a relationship with God, you enter into eternal life. If you don't have a saving relationship with God, then you will enter into eternal hell. And there's a comparison between the two. And it's interesting that Jesus, in all of those verses, makes that same comparison between life, which is eternal life, and hell, which is a place of torment, a place of judgment. He does the same thing in verse 47 with the eye. If your eye causes you to stumble, then pluck it out. That's his recommendation, because it's better to enter the kingdom of God. Now, before he said it's better to enter life. Now he talks about the kingdom of God, because the kingdom of God is life. And one day, people will enter into the kingdom of God. Those who believe, they'll enter into life. Those who don't will not experience the kingdom of God. They'll experience instead the judgment of God, which is here defined as hell. So again, those same ideas in all of this. And the idea is simply discard, get rid of anything that's keeping you from God. And we'll talk a little bit more about that, because he's going to give another example. Jesus says they'll enter into hell, and the word hell is Gehenna. The word Gehenna is used 12 times in the New Testament, and Jesus uses it 11 of those 12 times. So what is the story behind Gehenna? Because it's a fascinating one. The word Gehenna is a Greek word. It's a transliteration of the Hebrew phrase, the Valley of Hinnom. That's what Gehenna is. It's the Valley of Hinnom. And what took place in the Valley of Hinnom? Well, back in the Old Testament, what took place there was child sacrifice to Molech. Molech was the god of the Amorites, and people would literally sacrifice their children by throwing them into the fire to Molech. People actually did that. You know, today we look at that and go, what is wrong with those people? You know, how could a parent possibly sacrifice their child to a god? Well, they wanted the good favor of the god. And these people believed that Molech was the god of prosperity, the god of their crops. And if they wanted great crops, they had to sacrifice to the god. And sometimes that included sacrificing their children. Now, for pagan people in the Old Testament to do that, that's almost understandable. But for Jewish people to do that in the Old Testament is unthinkable. But they did it. I mean, didn't they read commandment number one? You shall have no other gods before me or beside me. We have Israelites sacrificing their children to Molech. King Solomon may have been involved in that. King Solomon, when he married all those women, brought all of their religious beliefs into the land of Israel, including child sacrifice to Molech. Now, in the ancient world, child sacrifice was not so uncommon. Many cultures did that. But the Jewish people were not to do that. And God, in fact, told them, don't do that. But they did it anyways. Well, this particular valley where this took place, this child sacrifice took place, it was desecrated by King Josiah. King Josiah was a good king. And King Josiah recognized what was going on and what the Israelites were doing. So basically, he tore down all of the altars. He got rid of Molech and all the statues, and he cursed the place. He desecrated the place, meaning nobody was ever again supposed to live there or build there, and especially offer a child sacrifice there. So basically, he cursed the land so that nobody would do this again. And so, what did the Jewish people do with the land that was now cursed? You couldn't build your house there. So they turned it into a garbage and sewage dump. So by the time of Jesus, this valley that's on the west and south side of Jerusalem turned into a sewage and garbage dump where people threw all their refuse in there, and the fire burned basically all the time, burning up all the garbage. And then this valley became a symbol for eternal judgment. And Jesus in Mark chapter 9 is talking about eternal judgment, and he's using that kind of image to do so. Now, with that in mind, let me show you the verses that back up everything I just told you. And it begins with Jeremiah, the prophet, telling the people of Israel, you need to repent, and you need to repent right now, or God's going to send the Babylonians to destroy you. And the people are going, well, what did we do wrong? And Jeremiah says, they have built the high places of Topheth in the valley of Ben-Hinnom. That's the valley of Hinnom. To burn their sons and daughters in the fire. That's what they were doing. Now, when you read about the sacrifices to Molech, a lot of modern people try to get around this idea because it's just so horrible that somebody would do that, that the phrase that they would pass through the fire, some people try to make the case that the children passed through the fire and they survived. But this makes it very clear that they didn't survive. This was a child sacrifice that was taking place. And what does God think about that? God says, that's something I did not tell you to do. In fact, God says, it didn't even enter my mind to have you do such a horrible thing. And the closest thing we find to that with God in charge is Abraham and Isaac. When God tells Abraham to sacrifice Isaac, but God intervenes and supplies the ram so that Abraham doesn't do that. It was a test of faith, and I think God tested Abraham's faith knowing he would pass because God detests child sacrifice. Some people have tried to argue that this was in many ways an ancient form of abortion. Abortion, of course, is taking the life of an unborn child. This was taking the life of a child that was born, a child living in your home of various ages. So maybe there's a connection between the two. Well, there's Molech. He's a bull god. He has his arms outstretched, and his belly happens to be a belly of fire. And so the children were brought to him, they were placed in his hands, and then placed into the fire as a sacrifice to him. And God considered that to be a detestable practice. In fact, it's one of the major reasons that the Israelites lost their nation in 586 BC. When the people asked Jeremiah, what have we done wrong? One of the things he mentioned was, you're sacrificing your children to Molech, and God's not happy about it. And God allowed the nation to be destroyed. 2 Kings chapter 23, verse 10 is the story of Josiah. So he is Josiah, and Josiah desecrated Topheth, which was in the valley of Ben-Hinnom, so no one could use it to sacrifice their son or daughter in the fire to Molech. Josiah knew it was wrong, so he desecrated the land, cursed the land, so that no one would ever do that again. Now we fast forward to the time between the Testaments. There's about 400 years between Malachi and Matthew. That time between the Old Testament and the New Testament. And there were books written by Jewish people during that time, but they're not included in our Old Testament or New Testament. They're called the Apocrypha books. They're not necessarily inspired, but they do give us some helpful information sometimes, including 1 Enoch chapter 27, verse 2. Don't try to look that up in your Bible. It's not there. But you can Google it if you want to read it online. And this is what it says. Then Raphael, one of the holy angels who was with me, answered me and said to me, "This accursed valley." The valley he's talking about is the Valley of Hinnom, that place where child sacrifice to Molech took place, is for those who are cursed forever. That valley is now the valley of judgment. And those who are cursed now get to be judged in the accursed place. Here will be gathered together all who speak with their mouths against the Lord, words that are not fitting, and say hard things about His glory. Here they will gather them together, and here will be their place of judgment. So now this valley becomes a symbol of judgment. Now we can look at Mark chapter 9, verse 48, which is a description of hell. Jesus says, you know, you've got a choice of, you know, cut off whatever's keeping you from God, because it's better to go into life, you know, without some body parts than to be cast with all your body parts into hell. And then he says, where the worms that eat them do not die and the fire is not quenched. That's Jesus' description of hell. It's also a very vivid description of that sewage and garbage dump on the south and west side of Jerusalem. They threw all their garbage in there, and the worms and maggots were there, and the fires burned continuously. But when Jesus said that, he was actually quoting the Old Testament. He was quoting Isaiah chapter 66, verse 24, where it says, "And they will go out and look on the dead bodies of those who have rebelled against me." And God is talking. And God is talking about people going out and viewing all the dead bodies of those who have rebelled against God. And the interesting thing about Isaiah 66, 24 is, this hasn't happened yet. So most scholars believe this is a reference to the Battle of Armageddon, when Jesus returns. And the armies of the world go up against Jesus. And it's no contest. And there will be so many dead bodies that they're just going to kind of lie there, dead, on the ground for a long time. And people are going to look out at them and view them. And then the worms that eat them will not die. So before the bodies can be buried, the worms are going to get to them first. And when the worms get to them, nobody wants to bury that body anymore because nobody wants to touch it. So the fire that burns them will not be quenched. So instead of being buried, the bodies will be burned. That's a description of those who rebel against God and who perish at the Battle of Armageddon. It also becomes a symbol of eternal judgment, eternal separation from God. So Jesus uses an interesting word as we come full circle again. Gehenna is the Valley of Hinnom. It's where child sacrifice to Molech took place. The site was desecrated by King Josiah, so that could never happen again. So that land got turned into a garbage and sewage dump, which became a symbol of eternal judgment. Jesus says, you don't want to go there. Gehenna is contrasted with life, eternal life, and the kingdom of God. So if you have eternal life, if you're part of the kingdom of God, you don't go there. But if you reject Christ, if you reject Him, then you can't be part of His kingdom. He can give you eternal life, but if you say no to Him, He can't give you eternal life. And the only place left for you is Gehenna. Then there's verse 49. And verses 49 and 50 are going to talk about salt and fire. Now, the connection between verse 49 and verse 48 is the word fire. We were talking about the fires of hell, the fires of Gehenna, the fires of the garbage dump. Now we're going to talk about a different kind of fire. And this fire is now going to be talked about in relationship with salt. Because there's going to be three statements about salt. And the word salt will be used in three different ways. The first two references are going to be a reference to judgment. And the third reference will be a reference to reconciliation. Well, here's the first reference to salt. Everyone will be salted with fire. This particular saying of Jesus is only recorded in the Gospel of Mark. You won't find it in Matthew, Luke, or John. Mark's the only one who records it. And it could be because the other gospel writers had no clue as to what Jesus was talking about. Because this saying kind of comes out of nowhere. You know, everyone will be salted with fire. What does that mean? Well, the source for Mark was Simon Peter. And Simon Peter obviously heard Jesus say this. And this is how Simon Peter most likely understood it. Because in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12, Peter writes, "Dear friends, do not be surprised at the fiery ordeal that has come on you to test you." What was the fiery ordeal? Persecution. Being salted with fire is a reference, most likely, to persecution. And Mark's readers, especially if they were living in Rome, had to eventually deal with Nero. And things got really ugly when Nero became the emperor and began persecuting Christians. It was a fiery ordeal that will test your faith. Persecution will either cause you to run or it will cause your faith to become rock solid. It will purify you or it will expose you as a phony in a hurry. So the fact that Jesus talked about everyone, for Mark's readers, chances are most of them, if not all of them, were facing some sort of persecution or will shortly thereafter face some sort of persecution. And that will test the genuineness of your faith. So, because of my allegiance to Christ, somebody took my possessions. Do I renounce Christ to get them back or just let them go? Because of my faith in Christ, my family has disowned me. Do I disown Christ in order to get my family back? Because of my faith in Christ, I may be facing death. Do I renounce Christ in order to save my physical life? Those were big decisions that people had to face. They were put in a fiery ordeal. They were salted with fire to see if they were genuine or not in their faith. And I think that's what Jesus was talking about when he talked about if your hand, you know, causes you to stumble, cut it off. You know, you don't want anything to keep you from your faith in Christ. So whatever it is, get rid of it because it's not worth it. This is the second statement about salt. It's in verse 50. And it's a completely different statement about salt. Now, salt is good. And salt is a good thing. It's a preservative. It's necessary for life. But if it loses its saltiness, how can you make it salty again? Well, as it turns out, pure salt will never lose its saltiness. However, in the first century, most of the Jewish people got their salt from the Dead Sea, and there were a lot of impurities mixed in. So if the real salt is removed, what you have is something that looks like salt, but won't function like salt. And Pliny the Elder wrote that salt from the Dead Sea can lose its savory quality and become tasteless. So that's what Jesus was talking about. It's salt that loses its saltiness. And most think this is a reference to a believer, the salt of the earth, who preserves the moral order, who is a reference point for spirituality for the entire world. But if a Christian loses their influence or stumbles in their faith, what's going to make them salty again? So again, Jesus is talking about purity in our faith. Don't lose your faith. And then there's a final reference to salt, and this one's different. Jesus says, have salt among yourselves. Salt is a preservative. What's going to preserve the relationship among the 12 disciples? Well, not arguing about who's the greatest. That's not going to preserve their relationship. If they continue arguing about who's the greatest, that relationship that they have with one another is going to fall apart. There's always going to be strife and conflict. But if they recognize in each other a common faith in Jesus and a common calling to serve one another, that will preserve their relationship. When Christians understand that their calling in life is to serve one another, they get along wonderfully. But when they start arguing about who is the greatest and who gets what position, things get ugly very quickly. Jesus says, have salt among yourselves and be at peace with each other. Well, those are some hard sayings from Jesus. And I'm sure at this point the disciples are squirming. What in the world is he talking about? You know, we thought that Jesus was going to establish this great kingdom and we're getting the top 12 positions and that's why we're arguing about who gets number one and who's stuck with number 12. But even if you're stuck with number 12, that's not bad. But now Jesus is talking about being salted with fire, and if something causes you to stumble, cut it off. What is he talking about? He's talking about the commitment that's necessary to follow Jesus. And especially for people in the first century, it was going to get difficult. Persecution was coming, and it would separate the phonies from the genuine. And Jesus says, be genuine and get rid of anything and everything that could cause you to stumble in your faith. Don't live for the things of this world. Live for the things of eternal life and the kingdom of God. That's what Jesus wants them to understand. But oh, it's very tempting to live for the things of this life. Especially when the message that we hear every day is, you need one of those. And if you don't have one of those, there's something wrong with you. And if you really want to experience happiness and joy in life, this is what you need. And we're told that over and over again. They're called commercials. And they're designed to sell you on something. But unfortunately, what they sell you doesn't last. It's not the true fulfillment that the kingdom of God brings. Well, let's pray. Heavenly Father, these are hard sayings that Jesus gives to us. Father, I pray that we will be genuine in our faith, strong in our faith, solid in our faith, that we won't allow the things of this world to destroy our faith, to cause us to stumble or to cause us to walk away from you. Father, thank you that you give us these words really of encouragement, that we need to be strong in what we believe, that we need to say no to the cries of culture and embrace the values of the kingdom of God. Father, help us to be kingdom people, living on this earth, doing your work, doing the things that you've called us to do with a servant's heart, a heart of love, and a heart that wants to help people and draw people and help people find you and find life in your name. So, Father, I pray that you'll bless the ministries Bless our conversations that we have with people. Help us to be about your business every single day, doing your work, spreading your message that others may hear. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.